Right, so right on time. Next up is from Adrian. He's going to talk about linear regression done in a private place.
Exactly. So is this all right? Is the volume okay? Yes. Okay. So I'm Adrià Gascón. I'll be talking about our work on privacy preserving linear regression. And this is a joint work with Philip Shopman, who's in the audience, Borja Baya, who I have to thank for some contributions to the slides, Mariana Rajkova, Jack Turner, Sami Zaur, and David Evans. We come from a variety of institutions. So I'll start with the motivation for the work. So consider the scenario where you want to predict the outcome of a certain treatment, and you have some medical data about a set of patients. But not only that, but you also have some census data and some financial data about that population, and this data is held by different parties. Okay? So this is commonly referred to as the vertically partitioned setting, as opposed to the horizontally partitioned setting. But for both settings, there are similar problems to the one that we deal with here at ICE. So hence, we have these parties that want to jointly learn a model on the union of their data sets, but they cannot share their private data with each other, maybe for ethical reasons or for regulatory reasons. And the assumption that we use in our work is that the parameters of the model will be received by all parties, so they have an incentive for putting their data together and getting a more accurate model. And parties can engage in an online secure communications. And we will also use external parties that help in the computation, but do not learn anything about the data, of course. So the easy solution for this problem is just to rely on a trusted party that gets all the data, computes the model, then sends the model back to the parties. The parties don't learn anything about each other's data. Then it removes the data and tries to forget everything it learned along the way. So the problem with this assumption is that sometimes it is difficult to enforce. It introduces a single point of failure. Yes, if the data is very valuable, there might be weak incentives for acting as a trusted party. And it requires an agreement between all the parties. So this is a useful assumption, but unrealistic. And the question is whether it can be simulated. We're in the MPC session, so you know it can. So here MPC comes to the rescue. So we've been already talking about this. We know that any polynomial functionality f can be evaluated in a privacy-preserving way, where you have different parties providing private inputs in a way that only the output of the computation is learned by the parties and nothing else. So we know that's the case. The problem is that for machine learning applications, the generic algorithms like garbled circuits or GMW and so on do not really scale. So we have to come up with a dedicated custom like algorithm that use several techniques to gain scalability for these applications where, for example, so in our examples you have like millions of records and hundreds of features. So these XIs are huge. So that brings us to our contribution, which is a system for doing linear regression in a privacy-preserving way in the vertically partitioned dataset setting. So the features of our system is that it does scale to millions of records and hundreds of dimensions in less than 1 hour, which is quite good. It has formal privacy guarantees, and we have an open source implementation that you can use. So as I said, we combine several tools like garbled circuits, oblivious transfer, this multiplicative triples generation that we saw before, and secret sharing. We implement efficient protocols for secure inner product and also a variant of gradient descent that is robust to fixed point encodings. And that's useful, and hence it's suitable for MPC implementations. So let's see what is this rich regression? What is that we implement in our system? So as I said, we have a data set that is vertically partitioned among several parties. Let's see, we only have two for simplicity. So this X is just a bunch of columns x1 held by party 1, followed by a bunch of columns x2 held by party 2, and then y is the column we want to predict on, which let's assume is held by party 1. So all we need to do in rich regression is very simple, is solve this optimization problem that turns out that has a closed form solution. So all we have to do is just, the parties have to compute this equation, construct this equation, and solve it. It's very simple. So this this gives us this very nice split of the problem where we have an aggregation phase where the parties compute a matrix A and a vector V, and a solving phase where they have to solve this system of equations and obtain the parameters of the model theta. Okay, so this is the computation. It's very simple, and this is all we need to do. So it's important to remark here that the input for the aggregation phase depends on the both on the number of records, which is of the order of millions, and the number of features, which is of the order of the hundreds. While the solving phase, in the solving phase, this have dimension d times d and d. So this is independent of the number of records. So it's important to have a very fast aggregation phase. So initially, the aggregation phase is going to be the bottleneck. So the observation here, or the useful observation, is that for even if you have n parties, for the aggregation phase that is computing this equation in a secret shared form, all you need to do is a bunch of secure inner product computations. So you can, all the aggregation phase reduces to computing the value of inner products between vectors held by different parties, private vectors held by different parties. So we implemented two efficient protocols for inner product. You can see the trade-offs in the paper. And then for the solving phase, all we need is a protocol for solving a linear system of equations. Okay, so let's look at, let's get an overview of the protocol. So as I said, at least in this version of the protocol, we have several in the paper. We rely on two external parties, the crypto provider and the computing provider, that will help in the computation while learning nothing about the data. And the assumption, the important assumption here, is that these guys, the crypto provider and the computing provider, are non-colluding. Okay, so this is sometimes referred in MPC as the two-server model. So this goes as follows. The crypto provider distributes some correlated randomness exactly along the lines of what you were explaining. And then the data providers engage in a bunch of inner product protocols to construct an additive share of the system that has to be solved. And then in a solving phase, the system of equations is solved by the crypto provider and the computing provider using a garbled circuits protocol. Okay, so the crypto provider will be the garbler, the computing provider is the evaluator who gets inputs in a secure way from the data providers and then evaluates the circuit, returns encryptions of the solution, the parameter of the model, the parameters of the model, and then the parties can decrypt the model with the help of the crypto provider. So this is it. And in the solving phase, so all I said is that we use garbled circuits to solve a system of linear equations. So all you need to know about garbled circuits at this point is that the functionality has to be represented using a Boolean circuit, okay? So the first observation is that inverting A is not a good idea in general. So there are other matrix factorization algorithms that are better than that. Among those, the ones that are based on pivoting are not a good choice because they are not data oblivious. They make decisions based on data, and that has a bad circuit representation, since all these choices has to be represented in the circuit. A good choice, instead, is this Kolesky decomposition, which works in this setting because A is positive semi-definite, and this was the choice done by Nikolaenko et al. In previous work. The only drawback of Kolesky is that it doesn't really scale to high dimensional settings, you know, like settings where you have more than 100 features, because accuracy decreases and the algorithm is exact, so you have to wait for the whole execution of the algorithm is cubic. Okay? So our proposal, so we thought, okay, let's go for an iterative method that will give us an improved solution at every iteration, and in this way we'll trade, you know, running time for accuracy. And these algorithms are quite stable, so that should be good enough. But so the problem is that in garbled circuits, we cannot do floating point computations yet. We are not quite there yet. And to give you a sense of where we are somewhere in the 60s, okay? So this is like computation in the clear, and this is computation in MPC, okay? So, but we are like getting there. And so what happens when you implement your CGD or the textbook CGD using fixed point arithmetic is that you lose the nice convergence properties of the algorithm in floating point. So in our paper, we show how to fix that and propose a fixed point CGD, a version of CGD that behaves, that recovers these good convergence properties and is as accurate as a floating point implementation, but of course faster in MPC. So we run an algorithm in a bunch of real data sets from the UCI repository. And so the results are in the paper, but I wanted to highlight a few things here. So if you look at this data set, where you have 50,000 records and 280 features, when we run CGD, it takes like 30 minutes, while Kolesky with 32 bits takes close to 1 hour, and it has less accuracy, while the CGD version is as accurate as the floating point version. So CGD is indeed better for bigger number of features. On the other hand, after having implemented a very fast aggregation phase, our bottleneck now is in the solving phase. So for example here, an example with 384 features takes close to 4 hours with CGD and 12 hours for Kolesky, while a huge data set with 4 million records, but only 16 features, can be solved in all cases in less than 2 minutes. Also, these numbers are already better than what I'm showing here, but along the same line. So in many cases, 32 bits are enough to good accuracy. So this is for the task of solving a linear system, for extracting this is for the task of prediction, not the task of solving a linear system. So results for that also in terms of different conditions. Matrices that are better and worse conditioned are also in the paper. So we analyze all the components of our solution in the paper. So to conclude, we have a full system that is accurate and fast. It's available as open source, so you can use it. There's already some people using it, so we're also very nice people that will help if there's any problem, so go ahead and use it. Scalability requires hybrid or custom MPC protocols, especially machine learning applications. And we propose this variant of CGD that has other applications than just linear regression, as it can be used in other machine learning tasks. So in terms of extensions, we like to really like extend this system that we put together, especially as it is open source. So there are a number of things that can be done. Distributed noise generation is a very interesting extension that we like to consider. And in particular, something that I really like to do is to implement really nice tricks that were presented earlier this year at SMP for this same problem, but by Mohassel et al. For future work, we like to consider other models. But the grand goal here is to construct a library of reusable ML components, something like a privacy-preserving NumPy. That'd be amazing. To complete the whole data science pipeline. So I'm not claiming here that one can do linear regression or the whole pipeline in a privacy preserving way, because you know, you're like tuning parameters and all that is something tricky. So the machine learning is often a feedback loop where you just try something, get results, and doing that in a secure way is not clear how to do it. So that's it, and I'll be happy to take any questions.